Pues.
Yes. Everybody knows this one? From when you were kids, right? This was years ago. To me, it seems like a new one.
I'm standing on the bridge. I'm waiting in the dark. I thought that you'd be here by now. There's nothing but the rain. No footsteps on the ground. I'm listening, but there's no sound. Isn't anyone trying to find me? Won't somebody come take me home? It's that damn cold night. It's trying to figure out this life.
Of course, the newer one is, what was I made for? Right? What was I made for? You're all familiar with that one, right? We already talked about that one. Same dilemma, right? When you're in that situation. Now, I know there are others that commit suicide that have hopeless situations that probably can't be fixed. No, that's something else that's out there, mental illness and things of that sort. And so what I'm concerned about is perfectly healthy people that are actually quite educated, and their education has led them to the point of view of not knowing what they've been made for, right? And in that case, you're in that situation. So that's my just Matt. And of course, in our country, the general goal of education and everything else is wisdom, somewhere in the middle, where you're familiar with all of the different positions, but at the same time, you use them perhaps for the right purposes, etc. So that's my cognitive map that kind of puts Aristotle where it seems to me he goes. So this is really a political tract, but starts off by talking about what the best form of government is, by establishing what virtues are and what kind of life individuals ought to try to seek. And as a result, of course, parents are trying to raise their children, because you can't be excellent in a vacuum. You can't be excellent without a community being excellent. So the trouble, of course, is not how do you raise a good child, how do you raise a good society so that they can have good children. That's where he goes. And I think as you're reading it, you can also sense an awful lot of Plato is behind his thinking. The belief that everything has a purpose, a telos, remember his name, Aristo Telos, the best purpose, strikes me as very strange that that's his name. We want to raise our children in the best way possible so that our society is going to be the best kind of society. And he very early on describes as being necessary to establish habits of action in order for you to establish virtuous habits. They don't happen naturally. Remember with Plato, there was this argument that I asked about, you know, do you think everybody's character is already established from birth? And most of you said no. Some of you said, well, it's kind of interesting, because that's the nurture-nature issue, right? And certainly, kids have a particular character right from the get-go. You know, ask mothers, you know, have had 3, 4, 5, 10, 15 children. You know, they know, you know, this character, this kid is, you know, fussier than this one. They all have something unique about them. But at the same time, clearly a process of habituating the child to a certain kind of practice is going to train the child Taking the child to music lessons, taking the child to sports lessons, taking early reading things. You know, you don't at college decide I'm going to read this 800-page book without ever read before. You have to start off with, you know, big bee, big brown bear, big brown bear, blue bull, big brown bear, blue bull, beautiful baboon, big brown bear, blue bull, beautiful baboon, blowing bubbles. This is the bee book, right? You know, if you're familiar with, you know, if you read to children, you memorize this stuff. And that's why, of course, when they're old enough, they don't want to walk next to you because you're still rhyming with Dr. Seuss. when you're, is your tongue numb, you know, as you go? And they want to get away from that. They don't want to associate with you at that point. So habits are important. That's totally different than Plato, that thinks that you're completely yourself, because your soul is the same soul, and so that soul is back again, you know, in a new body, but it's the same you, and so it already has a certain character. For Aristotle, no, you have to train the child, and so that requires training the child properly, which means, of course, you have to know it yourself. You know, so you need good trainers, and that's something that the society has to inculcate with its community. And he also points out that there are three types of constitutions or governments. The one type of government would be the rule of one. So an example of that would be an enlightened monarch. Later on, we'll see Thomas Hobbes, who's an Aristotelian, will argue that the best kind of government is an enlightened monarch. And that would work for him, especially because Charles II was his tutee. So he thought, Charles has been trained by the best. So Charles will be a good monarch. He's enlightened. I trained him. See how that works. Reminds me, though, of Heidegger, who thought he could train Hitler. And that didn't work very well, by the way. So that's interesting. But the trouble with a monarch, an enlightened monarch, well, they might be the best kind of government, because if you think about it, they can make decisions very quickly, the decisions will be correct, because they're enlightened, and their interest is totally one with the community. As Thomas Hobbes cover in his Leviathan, metaphor that the king, the state is I, as I think it was Louis the 15th said. In any case, as far as Aristotle's concerned, that would be the slickest form of government, you know, the most efficient. You have the best decision made, and it's one with the best of the community. The trouble with that kind of government, however, is that governments by the rule of a human being are ruled by a human being. I don't know if you've ever seen what happens to a human being when they get old. Well, Shakespeare gives us a very interesting example of that in King Lear. I thought I was going to get a good video right away, but how about here?
Sarah Phipps is the winner of 23 awards and the most royal party.
Hello, we have divided and see our kingdom. She thou hast intent to shake all cares and business of my age, conferring them on younger strengths. What amuse it to draw a third, more opulent than your sisters?
Nothing, my lord.
And nothing will come of nothing. Speak of it.
I haven't seen that one, but that one looks interesting. The new version of King Lear. But King Lear, it's called a tragedy. But Aristotle tells us that a tragedy is a play where the main character does everything right and still gets crucified at the end. I mean, dies at the end. Sorry. Trouble with King Lear is he does everything wrong. So strictly speaking, it's not a very good tragedy, at least as far as Aristotle is concerned. Instead, what happens is King Lear has gotten old and he's now senile. And your absolute monarch is now a crazy old man. You see with the kind of problem that Shakespeare is trying to deal with, you know, with that play. It's very tragic, of course. So that's the problem with a monarchy. What happens if you have a... theoretically, I should go to the place. Robin.
I think a more interesting definition of a tragedy that kind of jumps off of Aristotle is a tragedy is a play where the main character tries to do everything right and still fails in the end.
That's a good point. I'm thinking of some of the classics,
especially Shakespeare. His characters in his tragedies didn't always do everything right, but they tried.
Romeo and Juliet, that's a tragedy, right?
They certainly weren't trying to do the right thing.
No, they were trying. In their opinion, they were trying everything they could do to make this love work.
But that wasn't the culturally right thing to do.
Absolutely. Yeah, I agree with... what's your name?
Hudson.
Hudson. That was my dad had one of those.
Oh, what, a last name for first name?
No, he had a car named a Hudson.
Oh, okay. Great. Hudson Hornet?
I don't remember it being called a Hornet, but it was a big white one with a maroon top. And the neatest thing, you know, I was a kid, was the middle back seat folded down. It was neat until the third job arrived. But still, sorry. But that'll help you remember your name is Hudson. No, I agree. Romeo and Juliet, for their culture, did not do anything correctly. Juliet, especially, should have minded her parents and married the prince and stayed away from... I mean, obviously, the household is trying to make sure that this, you know, young male doesn't get anywhere near her, right? You know, it's pretty much... of course, the interesting foil in that one is the reverend who sets things up for failure by giving her the sleeping potion that will make her look shrunk deaf, right? Currently take over, you know, your, yeah, etc. And failing then to tell Romeo what's going on, and so he really believes she's dead. Of course, that's what screws things up in the end. But no, I wouldn't say that any of the Shakespeare tragedies fit the template that Aristotle gives a tragedy. Yes.
Did Aristotle also define comedy as things that start bad and end good? I'm thinking like the Divine Comedy.
No.
Not very funny.
No. His definition of a comedy is where the main character does everything wrong and still succeeds.
So then the Divine Comedy isn't a comedy by his definition.
No, and I don't think... I think that is satirical in that sense, because it's comic in that life is tragic, basically, and that's funny, you know. But the thing that strikes me is there are contemporary comedies that follow that rule perfectly. I think of Inspector Clouseau, the character that, you know, doesn't even know he's being attacked, drops the roll of toilet paper, reaches down to get it. Meanwhile, the two assassins shoot one another. You know, he avoids like three or four dangerous assassins, world-class assassins, the lady with the pretzels. You know, I don't know if you remember the movie, but basically, he's clueless. Inspector Clueless. Clouseau. And it's funny. It really is funny. Because he ought not to be successful. And yet, he is in every movie. Sorry. I really shouldn't do that when I don't have any talent.